comes from Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 to 14, which can be found in the Pew Bible on page 192. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, just as he chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world to be holy and blameless before him in love. He destined us for adoption as his children through Jesus Christ, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace that he freely bestowed on us in the beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of his grace that he lavished on us. With all wisdom and insight, he has made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure that he set forth in Christ as a plan for the fullness of time to gather up all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. In Christ we have also obtained an inheritance, having been destined according to the purpose of him who accomplishes all things according to his counsel and will, so that we, who were the first to set our hope on Christ, might live for the praise of his glory. In him you also, when you had heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and had believed in him, were marked with the seal of the promised Holy Spirit. This is the pledge of our inheritance toward redemption as God's own people to the praise of his glory. Our gospel reading comes from John chapter 6, verses 35 to 40, which can be found on page 98 in your Pew Bible. Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. But I said to you that you have seen me and yet do not believe. Everything that the Father gives me will come to me, and anyone who comes to me, I will never drive away. For I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I should lose nothing of all that he has given me, but raise it up on the last day. This is indeed the will of my Father, that all who see the Son and believe in him may have eternal life, and I will raise them up on the last day." The word of God.
I started the exam, I opened it up, I saw was Genesis 38. So I was excited because I knew the book, the story of Joseph comes at the end of Genesis. And then I read it. And well, let's just see if you reacted the same as I did when I read it for you. You see, later, Reverend Ed and Tilly and some other ministers would actually tell me that they think this is the hardest passage ever given on an ordination exam. Of course, it was on my exam. Now, I was going to say that before I begin, if there were any children here, this passage is sort of the rated R version of the Bible. But seeing no children, I'm giving it to you. Now, it happened at that time that Judah went down from his brothers and settled near a certain Adullamite, whose name was Hira. There, Judah saw the daughter of a certain Canaanite whose name was Shua. And he married her and went into her. She conceived and bore a son, and he named him Er. Again, she conceived and bore a son, whom she named Onan. Yet again, she bore a son, and she named him Shelah. She was in Chesed when she bore him. Judah took a wife for his firstborn son, Er. Her name was Tamar. But Er, Judah's firstborn, was wicked in the sight of the Lord, and the Lord put him to death. Then Judah said to Onan, "Go into your brother's wife and perform the duty of your brother-in-law to her, and raise offspring for your brother." But since Onan knew that the offspring would not be his, he spilled his semen on the ground whenever he went into his brother's wife, so that he would not give offspring to his brother. What he did was displeasing in the sight of the Lord, and he put him to death also. Then Judah said to his daughter-in-law Tamar, "Remain a widow in your father's house until my son Shelah grows up," for he feared that he too would die like his brothers. So Tamar went in to live in her father's house. In course of time, the wife of Judah, Shua's daughter, died. When Judah's time of mourning was over, he went up to Timnah, to his sheep shearers, and he and his friend Hira the Adullamite. When Tamar was told, "Your father-in-law is going up to Timnah to shear his sheep," she put off her widow garments, put on a veil, wrapped herself up, and sat down at the entrance of Enam, which is the road to Timnah. She saw that Shelah was grown up, yet she had not been given to him in marriage. When Judah saw her, he thought her to be a prostitute, for she had covered her face. He went over to her on the roadside and said, "Come, let me go into you," for he did not know that she was his daughter-in-law. She said, "What will you give me that you may come into me?" He answered, "I will send you a kid from my flock." And she said, "Only if you give me a pledge until you send it." And he said, "Well, what shall I pledge you?" She replied, "Your signet and your cord and the staff that is in your hand." So he gave them to her, and he went into her, and she conceived by him. And she got up and went away, and taking off her veil, she put on the garments of her widow. When Judah sent the kid by his friend, the Adullamite, to recover the pledge from the woman, he could not find her. He asked the townspeople, "Where is the temple prostitute who was at Enam by the wayside?" But they said, "No prostitute has been here." So he returned to Judah and said, "I have not found her. Moreover, the townspeople said no prostitute has been here." Judah replied, "Let her keep the things as her own. Otherwise, we will be laughed at. You see, I sent this kid and you could not find her." About 3 months later, Judah was told, "Your daughter-in-law Tamar has played the whore. Moreover, she is pregnant as a result of her whoredom." And Judah said, "Bring her out and let her be burned." As she was being brought out, she sent word to her father-in-law, "It was the owner of these who made me pregnant." And she said, "Take note, please, whose these are, the signet cord and the staff. Then Judah acknowledged them and said, "She is more in the right than I, because I did not give her to my son Shelah." And he did not lie with her again. The word of God for the people of God. It's definitely the word of God, not mine. Now, what was your reaction? Have you ever heard this story before? Now, I have heard this story before, but I can assure you it was not in a church and it was not in a sermon. And when I have read this story before, I sort of skipped over it because it's sort of a disruption in the Joseph narrative, and it never really made sense to me. And it was just an odd thing to occur in the Bible. So as I began my exploration for my exam, I turned to one of my favorite commentaries, who the book of Genesis was written by Walter Brueggemann, a well-known Old Testament scholar, very good at helping ministers with sermons. I thought for sure this guy would give me something theologically to go off of. But this is what he writes at the beginning of this section. "This chapter stands alone with seemingly no connection to its context. There is no evidence that it provides any significance. For these reasons, I will be brief with this section." Really? One of the go-to scholars doesn't give me anything to go off of? I'm working on an exam here. I'm starting to panic. Now, being the overzealous person that I am, I already had 10 other books, so I start working through them. One by one, everyone said the same thing. It's a disruption in the Joseph narrative. And the only possible reason is that it was redacted and that it was later put in to remind us that it was Judah, not Joseph, chosen by God to carry the promised seed. It was not until I got into my fifth commentary that I finally found someone who theologically looked at this passage. He pointed out Matthew 1, which is the only other time in the Bible that we hear the name of Tamar. You see, in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 1, which I was going to ask Linda to read, but I thought that was even more challenging than Genesis 38, because it's a list of names. It's Matthew's genealogy that tells us who the promised seed came through, starting with Abraham all the way to Jesus. And in Matthew's genealogy, it lists five women's names. Now, it's important to understand that Matthew's genealogy differs from Luke, as well as many other genealogies that are in the Bible, because most genealogies only mention the father and son's names, never women. So that must have meant that Matthew thought that these five women were important in the story of Jesus. I knew that this Tamar had to be important, but I had to discover how. What I realized is who Tamar came to be for me. I began to dig deeper and also realized that Judah wasn't such a bad guy after all. In this story, Judah begins trying to honor this Israelite levirate law, which is later explained in Deuteronomy. He comes to settle in the area of Canaan, and he takes a Canaanite wife. Now, this was very discouraged to take a wife outside of your tribe. Later in the Bible, it's even forbidden. It's the thought that in marrying these outsiders, they would draw you into worshiping their gods, disobeying the number one rule of the God of Israel. But Judah does this anyway. But we know he hasn't forgotten about his God of Israel because he follows this levirate law. this Israelite law, not Canaanite. And he gives Tamar to his second son. It seems ridiculous in our modern context to think of passing along a woman to another man as if she was an object. But there was reasoning behind Judah's actions. The Levirate law was in place because of the understanding of immortality of the time. You see, back then there was no heaven or hell, or life after life. There was only Sheol, where everyone went, good, bad, to remain forever. To be immortal meant that you had to have your name carried on. Your name was carried on by having male heirs. The inheritance law is also being implemented here. Another Jewish law that says the oldest male heir, the oldest son, would receive all of the property of the parents. Now, if that oldest son is to die without an heir, then this levirate law comes into place. And the wife is given to the second son, and the child produced by that will then be the oldest son's son and take on his name. And that son will receive all the inheritance. Now, the only way that the inheritance is passed down to the second son is if the first son's wife had never produced any heirs. So Judah here is following these laws. He's following the God of Israel. Yet we see his humanness in verse 11, because Judah succumbs to fear. He knows the law, but fears for the life of his son. After all, his first two sons are dead. And the only common denominator is this woman, Tamar. Now, as the story goes on, it says some time has passed, and Shelah, the youngest son, has already come of age to be given to Tamar. But Judah, conveniently, I would say, neglected to call her back for his third son. Now, even though Tamar was a Canaanite and raised with the Canaanite gods, she adopted the Israelite faith of her husband. And she followed what was asked of her father. She went to live in her birth father's house as a widow. She now realizes that not being given to Shelah means she may end up a widow for life. Now, in this time period, a widow for life was like a death sentence. See, a woman's only job in life was to produce heirs for her husband. Not only that, if she doesn't produce heirs, she has no one to care for her in her old age. She then decides to take matters into her own hands. She knows the levirate law. She has been following it, but now she's aware that her father-in-law hasn't. So she honors her husband by observing this law. She takes off her garb, presents herself as a prostitute to her father-in-law, at a time when she knows his inhibitions will be low. You see, his wife had just died and the mourning period was over. And there was a time to shear the sheep, which may not sound like much, but this was a time when the men gathered together, celebrating the blessings of all of the abundance from the sheep. And along with that celebration came partying, drinking. She knew he was going to be at the right spot for her to do this. puts herself out there, but with a veiled face. Judah walks by and falls right into her trap. So she says, like any good prostitute would, "What will your payment be?" And he offers a kid from his flock. Now she knew that she would need something for bargaining power in the future. So she says, "What will you give me for collateral?" And he agrees to give her some items of his that will definitely identify him and only him. The act of procreation has gone through. She is now pregnant. But she immediately returns to her father's house and puts on her widow's garments. Immediately is what's important to notice here. It reminds us that she had no intention of sleeping with any other man other than the one that would produce heirs for her husband. She's honorable. It is the same as if you were married to them. So if she went outside of that, she would be committing adultery. You know, Tamar knew all along that death was a possibility for her. But out of love for her husband, and to honor God, she acted courageously by sending a note with the collateral, identifying Judah as the father. Now, Judah could have hidden this and killed her anyway and solved all of his problems. But Judah again recalls the laws of his Lord. And he repents. He accepts his bad behavior. He confesses and endures the embarrassment. He even goes as far to declare that Tamar is more righteous than he because she followed the law of the God of Israel when he succumbed to fear. You see this bizarre, within this bizarre, erotic, awkwardly placed story is a biblical theme. God uses the most unlikely people in the most seemingly negative situations to further God's promises for the world. God uses the most unlikely people in most seemingly negative situations to further God's promises for the world. This risque, often overlooked story provides a theological theme that is relevant to our modern context and even to our own lives. Now, it took me a while to get there, but I noticed this. I noticed that I know people that feel unloved, unlikely to make a change in the world. Perhaps you feel unloved or unlikely to be chosen to further God's promises in the world. Perhaps you have looked at someone who was so far from likely to live out God's promises that you wrote them off. Well, it's important to recall at these times this story of Judah and Tamar. This rated R story that shows us that God uses the most unlikely people, you, I, everyone, to carry out God's promises in the world. We can have confidence that God can use absolutely anyone to further God's promises.